already deep into the difficulty of distinguishing between the different expertises of philosophers, scientists, the different claims, what belongs to what. So we're into the water. And our next speaker this morning is Professor Stathis Psilos from the Department of History and Philosophy of Science at the University of Athens. It is impossible to describe in such a short introduction the vast range of Professor Psilos' work, even if I try to focus on topics that are directly relevant to our subject. But if I need to choose one, and I will since I have to, then he's a leading thinker on contemporary thinking about scientific realism. Starting his 1999 influential book, Scientific Realism, How Science Tracks Truth, which is a definitive work in this field and whose description of realism became standard by now. Of course, he wrote other books and numerous papers on the main topics of general philosophy of science, including causation, laws of nature, and so on, and also looked at the history of the way we think about these ideas. The title of Professor Psilos' talk today is Laws of Nature, Revisiting the 17th Century Debate. Please.
Thank you very much. It's all an exaggeration, of course. It's kind of new work I've been doing over the last 2 years with a bunch of people, including Stavros, who's in the audience now, trying to look at how we came up with this concept of laws of nature and what the significance of the transition from a worldview which was based on powers, Aristotelian natural philosophy, etc., etc., to the modern view that nature is governed by laws, and to connect all this with current thinking about laws and powers and the resurgence of powers and the revamping of Aristotelian philosophy of science. So what I'm going to try to do in this talk is to... That's too small for me to read now. To tell you a little bit about the transition from powers to laws, but to shift the focus a little bit from necessity to non-necessity in nature, because it seems to me the real transition is not so much from a conception of nature which is governed by powers to a conception of nature which is governed by laws. That's an important transition already, but the significant conceptual shift happened in the late 17th century, early 18th century, where philosophers started to think as nature not being subject to necessary connections. And I'm going to try to map this debate a little bit, painting with quite a broad brush. And I'll start with a bit of a background. This is a very influential medieval philosopher, late medieval philosopher. Everybody knew Suarez and Hedred Suarez. Certainly Descartes was influenced by Suarez, Francisco Suarez or Suarez, who wrote a lot about everything. It's impossible to study him thoroughly and fully, I think. But it's interesting to see this kind of quotation by Thomas Aquinas, which Suarez quote, law is a certain rule and measure in accordance with which one is induced to act or is restrained from acting. And Suarez's complaint is that this definition would appear to be too broad and general, because law is a concept which is applicable only to rational beings. So only something that has the rationality to obey a law is subject to a law. Therefore, and that's a dominant thought. Even Aquinas uses the conception of law metaphorically. So laws require rational agency. A law is something that has to be obeyed or executed, and this can only be satisfied by rational creatures. Insofar as we use the conception natural law at all outside the mankind, it's metaphorical. And it should mean the inclinations imparted to things by the author of nature. So there is natural necessity in nature, and we can metaphorically give this natural necessity the name of law, But the proper content concerns natural necessities which are grounded in the natural inclinations, powers of things imparted on them by the author of nature. Now, to see what the dominant conception was back then, I've summarized, that's a long paper that I've been trying to put together on powers in Aristotle and medieval thinkers. But if we think of causal powers, these are some key characteristics of them. They're being posited as explanatory principles. That is, they contribute, they constitute the locus and cause of activity of in nature. They are posited to explain action and change, the movement and becoming. They can exist unmanifested. They are irreducible to their actualization. They can exist even if when they don't act. That's an important element. They are sui generis. They're principles of change in other things. Aristotle says that quite clearly a power is of a thing to act on another thing and produce a change in it. The power of a fire is to act on the wood and burn it. But the change happens only when the power are acting. So powers need activation, precisely because they can exist unmanifested. Powers are meant to ground the modal features of the world, their principles of necessitation. Powers act by conduct. That's a key Aristotelian thought. There should be action by conduct between the fire and the good. And that's an important issue. They inhere in substances. They're not free floaters. It's substances which possess powers, active or passive. Yet though powers depend on the intrinsic features of substances, powers are irreducible to further features of the substances. So, and that's a big shift in the 17th century, as you all know, that everything is matter in motion, whereas powers are sui generis. There is a power to burn, there is a power to go up, the power to go down. For each activity, there is a sui generis, irreducible power. Now, you all know that in the 17th century, there was a revolt against powers, and I'm going to go through very quickly some of the major arguments. There is the famous connection problem. How are powers connected? How is it that X having the power to fight and Y having the power to be fired, two distinct existences, the power has the fire has the power to burn, the wood has the power to be burned. How can they interact to give rise to an effect? And an argument that was put forward by Descartes, among others, was that the power of X to phi is not sui generis, but should be understood in terms of matter in motion, action by conduct of the parts of X on the part of Y. That's a very nice long quotation by Descartes. Someone else may, if he wishes, imagine the form of fire, the quality of heat, and the action of burning to be very different things in the wood. You may posit fire and heat in the wood and make it burn as much as you please, but if you do not suppose in addition that some of its parts move about and detach themselves from its neighborhoods, I cannot imagine it undergoing any alteration or change. So forget about sui generis powers, all is matter in motion, acting by conduct. There is an interesting problem which I don't want to talk about because it's going to take us too far afield, but powers were supposed to be directed. And had a kind of relational element, which is hard to fathom, but the idea was that the fire is related, the power of fire to burn is related to the power, to the passive power of the good to be burned. And an argument that again was put forward by Descartes is that only minds can have this directedness. And therefore, we can only think of physical objects as being directed to something else, only if we attribute to them little souls, as if they know what they are doing. And precisely because we cannot attribute to them little souls, they don't have physical directedness. That's another argument. That's the same argument. I do not suppose there are in nature any real qualities which are attached to substances like so many little souls to their bodies, etc., etc. I'm going to skip this over. The idea is that powers are supposed to be directed. Only minds can be directed. Therefore, there are no physical powers. There is a famous occultness problem, explanatory impotence. That's a famous letter that Descartes wrote to Huygens' father, Constantine Huygens. No natural action at all can be explained by these substantial forms, since their defenders admit that they are occult and they do not understand them themselves. These forms are not to be introduced to explain the causes of natural actions. There were other arguments about motion, whether things have the power to move. That's another argument by Malebranche, which is very interesting because it's supposed to show that powers do not have an internal power, that objects do not have an internal power to move. And the idea is that God creates everything. God puts everything in a certain place. So if God wills this chair to be here, he puts a chair here. So if the chair moves by its own, it's supposed to have a power which is not there in God. So it's going to have a power which is going to exceed God's power to move it, and that's impossible. Therefore, the chair should stay there, and only God can actually move it about. And the same goes for interaction. If you push this chair and bang the table. Now, the debate is complicated, but the two major strands in the 17th century is that matter exists, but God is the only motive force, which came to know as occasionalism, but Malebranche was a major exponent. And of course, there was the Berkeleyan reaction to that, which was roughly that if matter does not do anything, why do we need it? Why do we need, I mean, God does anything, everything, and minds do everything. Matter is impotent, why do we need it? So, there is matter, but God does the things, and there is no matter, and God does the things. That's Berkeleyan idea. These are the two main tendencies after Descartes, but, and that's an important but, in all post-Cartesian thought, God acts on nature by means of laws. So there is no power in nature, and there is no power either because there is no matter for it to be powerful, or there is matter but it's not powerful. But in any case, or in all cases, laws replace powers. They provide the missing connection between distinct existences. But, and that's an important part I want to stress, they don't replace necessity. There is still necessity in nature. They capture the necessity there is in nature. And grounded actually in God and his attributes. So there is an interesting question which I want to explore a little bit. How do laws acquire their necessity, and what kind of necessity this is? Now, Bernard referred to Descartes' Principia already. God is the primary cause of all motion. Laws of nature become themselves. Descartes says the particular causes by which individual parts of matter acquire movements which they did not previously have. Laws account for changes of states of motion of bodies, and as he put it in Le Monde, the rules or laws of nature, in the Principia, sorry, the rules or laws of nature are the secondary and particular causes of the diverse movements which we notice in individual bodies. So laws determine what happens when a collision takes place and when it does not, but how can laws be causes? That's an important conceptual question. Now, we all know that Descartes put forward the first important conservation principle, the conservation of the total quantity of motion, and not momentum, of course, in the universe. And this principle is very fundamental because it stems directly from the immutability of God. So it's not as if God willed the motion to be conserved. Because he's immutable, he decides to put a certain quantity of motion into the world, to set the world in motion, and because he's immutable, this quantity is conserved. So it's not an extra law, or it's not an extra principle, it flows directly from the immutability of God. It is grounded in the immutability of God. Given his volition to put the world in motion, which is an act of his will, he might have decided not to put anything in motion. This principle is metaphysically necessary. God being what it is, the principle he has to hold in all possible worlds in which matter is in motion. On this principle now, Descartes grounds his three laws of motion. They are part of the fabric of the world. It's not as if God imposed them on the world from without. Given his immutability and the principle of conservation of the total quantity of motion, the fundamental laws are constitutive part of nature. Everything that happens in nature is subject to them. Motion is regulated by God via laws subject to an overall principle of conservation of quantity of motion. Because God moved the parts of matter in diverse ways when he first created them, and still maintains all this matter exactly as it was in its creation, and subject to the same law at that time. He also always maintains an equal quantity of motion. Now, we don't have to go through these three laws. The first two laws are basically a rough version of the principle of inertia. The third law talks about what happens when there is collision, and of course all change in nature is by collisions in Descartes. I'm going to skip that. So what does it mean to say that laws are the secondary and particular causes of the diverse movements? And the way I take this, I read Descartes, is this. Given that bodies were set in various states of motion in the beginning, laws cause their particular states. Why does X move in a straight line? Not because it has a power to do that, but because it is a law that it will keep moving. It won't change its state of motion until something stops it. That's the first law. In this sense, law is the cause of the movement, since it dictates, determines the motion. Why does X stop moving? Not because it has any power to do that, but because it is a law that X must change its state of motion if it collides with another body Y, etc., etc. So, if we were to sum up, and that's a long story, I could talk a lot about that. Cartesian laws are difference makers. All phenomena in nature are counterfactually dependent on laws. If the laws had been different, the world would have been different. Laws are counterfactually robust. Descartes tells a creation story, and the laws would be the same, no matter what the initial conditions were. Laws are metaphysically necessary, since they are grounded in the immutability of God. Laws are immanent in nature. They are not imposed from God by God from without, but they flow directly from his immutability. And laws are causal principles, since motion of the various bodies in the world happened because of them and not simply according to them. But how does matter execute the laws? How does matter obey? Matter is passive. That's a famous Cartesian principle. If matter is inert and lacks any motor force, how is it that pieces of matter are subjected to the causal action of laws? Descartes makes clear that there is no innate tendency to motion. And that's an issue in Descartes' thought, and scholars have, throughout the centuries, thought about this. What happens with motion? It doesn't seem that Descartes has a coherent view about what happens when two things collide. Is motion transferred or not? The cleanest solution to this puzzle in the 17th century is occasionalism. Occasionalism is misunderstood. But occasionalism was meant to address the problem of motion. And the thought is that this matter is truly inert, lacking any motive force. The only real direct cause should be God. Like it or not. I mean, that's the consistent Cartesian way to think about motion. But how does God act on matter? Via laws. So laws are essential part of the occasionalist view of physics. But unlike Cartesian laws, occasionalist laws are not grounded in the immutability of God, but in his will, in the ways of his acting. God always acts in the simplest ways. He always acts with general laws, or what Malbrand said, general volitions. So laws are God's general volition. They're his decrees. And in this sense, they're not metaphysically necessary. God could have willed different laws. They're only ex hypothesis necessary. They're immutable, given that God decides to pick this set of laws to govern the world, but they are free choices of God. And God actually might will to change the actual laws. Malbrand says if God decided to create incorruptible bodies, he would change the laws of nature. So they are not metaphysically necessary, but once they are decided, then they govern the behavior of things. But and that's an important thing, because the laws of nature are constant and immutable. They're general for all times and for all places, Malbrand says, given that God has picked a certain set of laws. And everything is a necessary consequence of the laws of the communication of motion that God has established. So not only are laws are not metaphysically necessary, But once they are picked, there is natural necessity that these things happen as necessary consequence of the laws. Now, I'm going to skip that. How are laws executed by matter? And the answer is clear here, they are not. Matter is inert, they are not executed by matter. God himself executes the laws. How does that happen? The two principles of occasionalism, as Malebranche says, our bodies lack motor force. God acts on nature via general laws. Now, these two principles make it the case that God communicates his power to us only through the establishment of certain general laws, the realization of which we determine through our various modifications. Now, there are some interesting things to be noted here. The laws must be executed by God, since matter cannot execute them, but they are realized in natural causes via the modifications, that is, the various properties. So in a collision between two bodies, X is not the cause of the motion of Y. X communicates nothing of its own to Y, yet there is a redistribution of motion between X and Y according to a certain law. God acts according to a law which causes the redistribution of motion. All communications of motion are executed by God, but they're executed by a general law. The action of natural causes consists only in the motor force activating them. So there is no room for connecting entities like powers, active qualities in this scheme. The link between God, which is the only power, and the regularity that is in the world is laws. God's decrees, which are literally directly realized by natural bodies and their motion. So there is regularity in the world, but laws ground the regularity and explain the regularity, and these laws are grounded in God. So laws are not metaphysically necessary. Malebranche is very clear, regularity does not imply necessity, but the law is not the regularity itself, it is a principle which grounds the regularity. Insofar as the laws of nature are part of the fabric of nature, however, there is necessity in nature, though this necessity is not located or grounded in the bodies by themselves, nor can it be inferred by experience and by the regularity there is in nature. Now, am I okay on time? There is the big break in this Cartesian framework is Leibniz. And Leibniz is known for very many things. Most of all, he's known for the fact that he says Descartes was wrong in thinking that the quantity of motion is conserved. It's the quantity of momentum, vis viva, of kinetic energy, we would say today. But the important break was that he thought that the whole framework of passive bodies and active laws is incoherent. So you need both. You need the laws and you need the natural bodies to have powers to obey the laws. And then in a letter to Bayle, he says, general laws, they are in need of a natural means of carrying them out. All that happens must also be explained through the nature which God gives to things. So for Leibniz, matter must have the power to obey the laws, so matter must be active. And that's what I call Leibniz's problem. How can passive matter obey laws? How are laws executed if matter does not have what it takes to execute them? That is the power to execute the laws. And that's an unknown argument by Leibniz, which I want to go through very quickly why this is necessary. Laws are certainly God's decrees, God sets up the laws, but for bodies to be able to execute the laws in the future, something must have been impressed upon creatures by God when he makes them capable to act according to the law. For otherwise, there are no necessary connections between causes and effects. The command, that is God's law, is either not binding at future moments, or it must always be renewed in the future. God must give the command 10 minutes later to this body to keep falling down, as it were. The command, which was set in the beginning of time, is binding now and in the future only if the law set up by God does in fact leave some vestige of him expressed in things, and this implies that there is a certain efficacy residing in things and creatures in general. It is this efficacy which makes them capable of fulfilling the will of him who commands the motion of the bodies. This efficacy is part of their nature and it's a force from which the series of phenomena follows according to the prescription of the first command. What's the alternative if you don't like this idea? It's occasionalism. God acts all the time, but that's a continuous miracle. It's as if God, as a rule, interfered in some other way than by preserving its substance in its course and in the laws established for it. Now, because I'm running out of time, I'm going to skip and come to a diagnosis and then a solution, which is again historical. So the diagnosis is this: from powers as regularity enforcers, we move to laws as regularity enforcers. Powers, there's bottom-up necessity. Laws are metaphors for natural and necessary connections among powerful substances. But power is inscrutable and redundant. There are no powerful substances. Laws replace powers as principles of connection. The necessity is top-down. They derive the necessity from a lawgiver, and they determine how things behave in the world, that is, what regular patterns there are in the world. Laws are behind the regularity there is in the world and ground the regularity. But there is a tension, which is surfaced by Leibniz. How can things obey laws if they do not have the power to do so? How can a powerless matter execute the laws? And that's how powers come into the picture again by Leibniz, in virtue of which bodies are subject to laws and are capable to execute, obey the laws. Now, given that, there is a stalemate. But back to Aristotle in some sense or other. Not so, because conceptually and historically, there are two routes to follow. One is by Hume, who says there is no necessity in nature, there is no power in nature, there is only regularity in nature. You all know that. The idea here is that there is just a regularity, nothing beyond that. The law is the regularity, if it is anything at all. And there is no power in the bodies or God behind the laws to make them to be the case. But I want to focus for the last 5 minutes or so on Newton, because I think Newton makes a really serious move in this debate. Because with Newton we find for the first time the thought that laws and powers are mutually determined. To introduce a power is to introduce a law that governs its behavior, and we need to compare Newton with Descartes, because Newton introduces the power of matter of resisting by means of a law. The definition 3 of the vis in sita, or innate force of matter, is a power of resisting by which everybody, as much in it lies, that's a famous word, expression, quantum in se est, as much as in it lies, continues in its present state, whether it be of rest or of moving uniformly towards in a right line. And then we've got law 1, the first law, and look at the wording: everybody perseveres in its state of being at rest or of moving uniformly straightforward, except insofar as it's compelled to change its state by forces impressed. In a certain sense, these two principles are the mirror image of each other. The definition defines the power by means of the law, and the law says how the power is being executed. The definition defines a power of a body that a body has intrinsically by stating the law it obeys quantum in se est, insofar as in its own. In the law, Newton states what happens in a body if the intrinsic power is not the only one acting on the body, i.e. if it's not quantum in se est. Now, that's Descartes' first law, and see this thing over here. Descartes' first law says that each thing, quantum in se est, always remains in the same state, and that consequently, when it is once to move, it always continues to move. For Descartes, there is just a law, there is no power. There is no definition of a power via the law, there is just a law. Insofar, and that's a magic expression, which I looked it up. It's both in Newton and Descartes, and there is lots of speculation because of this that Newton had actually left the Principia, but it's everywhere. You find this expression in Aquinas, in Leibniz, and it's meant to say what a body does when it does not interact with other bodies. Now,
just three, four minutes,
okay. Now, there is this famous preface by Coates, the second edition of the Principia in 1713, and this was written under Newton's close supervision, so it expresses Newton's views. That's very clear. So to support the point I'm trying to make, let's look at this preface. So Coates says, the guy that I'm prefacing his book
is both against Aristotelians and Cartesians, and he's putting forward the true method of science. Okay? And of course, why is he against Aristotelians? Because he's against specific occult qualities. So the scholastic doctrine derived from Aristotle and their peripatetics is bankrupt. They do not tell us the causes of those natures, and therefore they tell us nothing. So the way powers were introduced by the Aristotelians is bankrupt.
How about the Cartesians? What does he say against the Cartesians?
Now, the problem against the Cartesians is that, of course, they want to reduce everything to mechanical causes of the phenomena. And for Newton, and that's important, there are primary affections of bodies, and since they are primary, they do not depend on others.
So there are things which are not mechanical, or might not be mechanical, or they might not be admitting mechanical explanations. So these primary affections are not further reducible. They are primary, but they are fully captured by the laws that bodies which bear them obey. And gravity is such a case of a primary affection. Among the primary qualities of all bodies, blah, 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 gravity it is.
And of course, gravity is not occult because it is enough that gravity really exists and acts according to the laws
that we have set forth and is sufficient to explain all the motions of the heavenly bodies of our system. So it's okay to introduce primary affections, that is powers, provided you connect them with the law through which they act and the law they obey. And that's a Newtonian method. Again, from Coates' preface, from certain selected phenomena, they deduce by analysis the forces of nature and the simpler laws of those forces from which they then give the constitution of the rest of the phenomena by synthesis.
Now, that's a letter Leibniz wrote to Hartsweiker, but the idea here is that although Leibniz thought that there are laws and powers,
powers are individuated independently of laws. So my schematically put diagnosis is that Descartes said, just laws, no powers. Leibniz, first the powers, then the laws. Newton, powers and laws get into the world together. Now, there is some discussion I had with Mauro yesterday about laws. Newtonian laws are not metaphysically necessary because God could have established other laws. We have traces of the highest wisdom, but no traces of necessity, Coates says. All we can do is basically observe an experiment to find the laws.
That's another interesting argument here. There are no traces of necessity because in the Newtonian tradition, we cannot find out a priori what the laws of nature are. If we found that out a priori, we would be in the mind of God, and we cannot read the mind of God. God can do whatever he wants with the laws. Therefore, the only way is basically to discover the laws empirically by induction and experiment, but this does not mean
that they don't hold with some kind of necessity. In my own reading, Newton thought laws hold by some kind of necessity since God picks them out ultimately, but this necessity is ineffable. The only thing we can do is fathom it by finding the laws empirically. What are the laws ultimately? The will of God. In this sense, they are naturally necessary connections in nature,
but the only way to find them out is empirically and hence fallibly. Unlike Hume, he takes it to be the case that laws are not mere regularities, but they can be known to us only as mathematically characterized regularities. So if there is natural necessity in nature, and Newton seems to think that there is natural necessity,
it can never be found out. Now compare it with Hume, if God is left out of the picture, and if natural necessity cannot be otherwise grounded in nature of powers, all we are left with are regularities which can be known as mathematically characterized regularities, and these are the laws of nature. Who said this? Astronomers had long contented themselves with proving from the phenomena the true motions, order, and magnitude of the heavenly bodies, till a philosopher at last arose who seems from the happiest reasoning
to have also determined the laws and forces by which the revolutions of the planets are governed and directed. The philosopher who at last arose is Newton, but who said this about Newton? An ice cream to whoever finds it.
Hume.
You got it. That's David Hume. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thanks.
Yes.
for this great talk. This is just a matter of clarification. I think they found this manuscript, the Gravitationes and Equipondio Fluidorum, where there are a lot of notes that Newton himself wrote, which they seem to be evidence for his having read the Principia. So what is the counter evidence? And don't you think that force, the notion of force, replaces the notion of power? And the third is really very fast. Newton tried for a long time to find a sort of mechanical explanation of gravity. So why would you think that he considers gravity as a primary effect?
Yeah, all three points are great. The grav is a huge thing. We've been working on it. I know how to incorporate it into the story, but it's going to take time for me to explain. There are two problems with the grav. A, we don't know when it was written. There's speculation about when it was written, whether it was written, it's a primary text, or it was written just before the Principia. No, we don't know that. No one knows exactly when it was written. There is speculation. Opinion is that it was written just before the Principia, but it's no hard evidence for this. And the grav is a good point for the story, because in the grav, A, we know that he read the Principia, and he talks about, criticizes Descartes and the relativity of motion as being incoherent, but more importantly, he introduces a creation story in which God creates a world, and he creates things in the world by giving them basically three powers. The power to occupy space, the power to move, and the third is the power to cause sensations to us. And how do you find the power to occupy space? If you press something here, Newton says, and it resisted, if you couldn't push your hand through this space, there is something that resists. There must be an object here. So he introduces object by means of the powers it possesses. Forces for Newton is the valid residue of power, it seems to me, because he wants to understand them mathematically and give them an introduction by means of laws. And the third question is about mechanical explanation. Now, that's a big question here, because it might be that Newton said force to introduce a power is to introduce a law, but this does not imply that there is more to be told about the power itself and whether it can be identified independently of the law, as it were, by means of its mechanical causes, if there are any. So in this sense, he might left that possibility open, that there is some way to identify the power by giving a mechanical explanation of it independently of actually presenting the law of gravity, for instance, the inverse square law that it obeys.
It's just a quick question about Leibniz, because you didn't mention the monadology in monads. Yeah. And I was thinking at some point, did it ever happen in Leibniz that he actually sort of agrees with Descartes, all the things would need a little soul in order to obey a law, and that's why he, in a sense, attributes a little soul to every little bit of matter.
Yeah. I skip this point because there are various reasons why Leibniz introduced this idea of a soul-like entity, that everything is a soul. But I think part of the problem is that force or power for Leibniz implies directedness, implies a kind of intentionality, which only souls can have. So ultimately, everything being powerful, having an innate active power to behave in a certain way, implies that it's a soul-like. So in this sense, he would agree with Descartes. But he wouldn't agree with Descartes about, clearly about forces and laws, because for Descartes there is no... Descartes talks about forces, but he doesn't quite talk about them. He doesn't want to talk about them. Force is an anomaly for Descartes.
About the necessity of laws of physics, could we look at it as, all the laws of physics as being in equilibrium in the sense of game theory? For example, given all the laws except for F equals M times A, suppose that you change it to F equals M times A squared, could the world exist? So if not, then this is the necessity. One could ask whether we can change the whole equilibrium to another set of laws. But in this sense, given all the rest of the laws, every law is necessary.
in a certain sense, if Bill Harper, our common friend Bill Harper, was here, who was a Newton scholar, he would say that's exactly what Newton thought, because in a sense, what Newton said is that it's not just that it's the law of gravity, is that if the law of gravity had different exponent, then we would have observed deviations from the in the motion of the planets, and if it had a different ratio, again, so the counterfactual stability of laws is a way to address why they hold by some kind of necessity. But what kind of necessity is this? It simply says, given the initial conditions of the universe, the world evolved in a certain way. It doesn't mean that it couldn't have evolved in a different way. We couldn't have been here, maybe, to talk about that. But that's a different issue. So what I'm thinking about when I think about these issues is basically how we came up with the idea of necessity in laws. And the answer to this question is we don't have powers to ground the necessity in nature, so the necessity should be grounded in God, something external. And then the solution to this question is this: either there's no necessity, let's live with that, or somehow primitivism, that there is some kind of necessity in nature, but we don't know its source, it's there, and it's not grounded. Or again, going back to powers and say it's grounded in powers, neo-Aristotelianism. So that's roughly the landscape, as far as I can tell. And I don't know where I stand at the moment. Mm-hmm. I knew until a few weeks ago, but not anymore.
One last question, Bernie.
Yeah, I may have misunderstood Newton's position because you went very,
very
quickly.
That's my trick.
But I'm wondering the extent to which laws would be dispensable in a system, because what's primary are the powers, and laws are manifestations of the combination of powers, right? So, for instance, he would talk about Kepler's laws, but they don't directly sort of correspond to some power in the planets, right? I mean, they follow from the original powers of gravity and inertial motion.
There are Kepler's laws are laws precisely because there is a universal law of gravity. There is no if and only if there. There's universal law of gravity, if and only if, the area law and the harmonic law. Now, that's exactly the point I wanted to make, namely that for Newton this question is answered by saying that to introduce a power is to introduce a law. To introduce a power is to introduce a law. It's not as if you introduce first a power and then you specify the law it obeys, or so you saw that there is a law flowing from it. Say that's more or less Leibniz's view. For Newton, I think that's a big break, is that there is no more content to the talk about powers than giving the law that this power obeys. And don't necessarily ask for a further explanation of its grounding, which might be available or not. But insofar as you've introduced the law, you've explained enough about the power to use it in physics and explain everything on its basis. So you don't do it separately, you do it in the same act. So the law of the power of gravity is encapsulated by the law of gravity. And the law of gravity does capture what we can meaningfully say about gravity for you.
But then you can dismiss one of them. I mean, like, why do we need them as sort of metaphysical grounds?
That's what Jung did. Removing power is just a regularity.
No, I'm thinking remove the regularity part. Like.
No, but it's as if you don't, you know, if you say I can meaningfully use both concepts, but only if I introduce one by virtue of the other, even only if, as it were, you don't dispense with them. You don't have to do that. You don't. Reduction has to have an arrow which says this is primary, this is not. It doesn't have to go that way. It says, you know, you take them together or you don't take them together. You don't have to answer the question what's more fundamental. That's precisely where Newton, I think, makes a break.
Okay, just a short question. Till 18th century, we have four options. No necessity at all, just regularity. Necessity is grounded in powers, the second option. Necessity is grounded in laws, a third option. And necessity is grounded in both powers and laws. And my question is, did 20th century philosophy of science or science add a new option, something different from these four options?
No.
Oh, because there are people who pretend they have added a new option.
There's lots of illusion in philosophy.
Okay, okay, we'll discuss that.
Primitivism has become more transparent in the 20th century, it seems to me. That somehow there is primitive necessity. We should start with some kind of necessary connections and see how far we can go on the basis. Maudlin and Carroll and a few other people. But all this Aristotelianism, Arthur, contingent necessitation, regularity, etc., they are basically, you can map them to this debate in one way or another, it seems to me.
Okay, it's a long discussion. Yes. I promise a short.
We'll end here because we're off to some coffee. So thank you very much.